One of my favorite things about horror as a genre is how single-minded it is in its goal of making you uncomfortable. It's like comedy. It doesn't matter how you achieve the end result. And also in that loud noises are typically a viable shortcut. But the point is, there's not much of a budgetary barrier to entry when it comes to making horror games. There are a lot of tools out there to make games for cheap or even free, and if you've got an idea and know your limits, you can make a horror game with them. One of the most prolific of those tools being RPG Maker. As the name would imply, it was originally intended for making your own little RPGs. So it was a top-down pixel art engine with a lot of simplified, consumer-oriented tools for things like interacting with NPCs, battle systems, inventories, progression, that sort of thing. And you can make a horror RPG. Sweet Home is considered one of the first real horror games. Some classics of RPG Maker horror, like the original Corpse Party, do use the progression and battle systems, but here's the thing. Most people aren't using RPG Maker to make horror games because they want to do their own riff on RPG horror. Most people are using it because making games is hard. It's bad enough figuring out the art and the music and the story and figuring out how all that's gonna link together and testing to make sure it works without having to do things like, I don't know, build a movement system and control scheme from scratch or troubleshoot to make sure people aren't falling through the floor or losing their saves for no reason. RPG Maker takes all the basic engine level work out of the equation, so you just get to focus on the creative stuff. And it just so happens that a lot of the tools they created for you to make RPGs with can also be used to make rudimentary adventure games. The way I see it, there's two vastly different ends of the spectrum when it comes to these things. On one end, you got Aoni, which is maybe the most famous RPG Maker horror game. It came out in 2008 and got periodic updates up until 2011. And the reason it's so big is YouTube. The general time frame that Aoni came out and was getting updates was also the general time frame that videos of people playing games where you run from goofy-looking monsters and solve puzzles were pretty big. I don't really think Aoni was chasing trends, I think it was just a happy accident. One that resulted in the game getting a huge fan base. And also spawning a live-action movie, which is bad. And an anime, which is... But how is the game itself? Well, it's... okay. It's pretty much the baseline average RPG Maker horror game. All the basics are there and executed reasonably well without any standout presentation in terms of visuals or sound. The story and gameplay are both pretty good indicators of what you can generally expect from these types of games. A group of friends are locked inside a creepy mansion and have to go around solving puzzles and trying not to get killed by a monster. You spend most of your time encountering puzzles and finding items to use on other items to solve those puzzles because, at its core, it's an adventure game. Right down to a lot of the puzzle solutions being obtuse as shit. Really, the most unique thing about Aoni is the game's namesake. I mean, look at this fucking guy. Despite me opening by comparing this game to Amnesia, the thing is, the monster chasing you was actually kind of a differentiator when it came to RPG Maker games. Plenty of these games have chase sequences, but very few of them have the constantly looming random chance of running into the monster the way Aoni does. Which is probably because it kinda sucks. I'm generally not a huge fan of that style of gameplay anyways, but at least in a game like Outlast, you're moving around 3D space with a character who's kinda nimble. Not locked to a grid with four movement directions. Overall, Aoni isn't the best or worst RPG Maker horror game, but it's understandable that it's a lot of people's first. And on the other end of the popular RPG Maker spectrum, you've got Yume Nikki. If Aoni is the most bankable game to come from this, Yume Nikki's probably the most respected. That's not to say it's not also successful. There's a manga that's pretty decent, fan games that are good, and a side-scroller reimagining that's not. It's at a point where it's kind of transcended the label of RPG Maker horror and just become its own thing. There's not a ton of RPG Maker mechanics in Yume Nikki because there's not a ton of game mechanics in Yume Nikki. it's essentially a game about wandering around a big empty void and seeing cool shit. That might sound reductive, but it's extremely good at being that. All of the story is relayed wordlessly, and the puzzles, if you can even call them that, are more about discovery than actual logic. I don't have a lot to say about Yume Nikki, partially because it's already been dissected to death, and partially because it's just perfectly simple. It's just a really pure example of surreal horror without any extra shit in the way. So now that we've got a vague idea of the broad range of things you can make with RPG Maker, I want to talk about stuff that people have made with it. Problem is, there's a shitload of RPG Maker games out there. Even just the good stuff would be too much for one video. I could just talk about my favorites, but I don't know why I'm not just doing that, but I'm not. In order to get a sufficient sampling platter of RPG Maker games, you'd have to make a list of them and then randomize it. Pick names out of a hat, spin a wheel. You saw the name of the video, you know what this is. On this wheel, I have an assortment of RPG Maker games. Ones I've played before, ones I haven't, ones that are classics, ones that aren't. We're gonna spin this wheel 5 times, and those are gonna be the games I play. That's the video. Alright, let's cut the preamble and get to the first game. What do we got? Oh, alright. Okay, I'm just gonna get this out of the way right now. Mad Father is technically made on Wolf RPG Editor, not RPG Maker. So this video is immediately a sham. That said, there's a reason people always lump this game in when they're talking about the big boys of RPG Maker horror. It's very solidly put together. It has most of the hallmarks of these games. Big spooky mansion, lots of gore, adventure game bullshit like having to read a children's book about setting people on fire before you can set a giant writhing mass of human flesh on fire. You know, normal type shit. There's enemies you gotta avoid that will stunlock you, and quick time events that give you pretty much zero visual indicator that you're pressing the button, but they do play kind of a jam. Two things about Mad Father that really stand out to me are the sound, which is both effectively creepy, and really pretty when it wants to be. And the story is actually kind of unique. It follows Aya, whose father is He's real pissed. He's been doing shady human experiments for as long as she can remember, and she's fine with it. That's what I think is interesting about the story. They could have gone the easy route and made the father abusive, or had Aya finding out about his experiments be the kickoff event for the game, but they don't really do either of those. By all indicators, he's a genuinely caring father and husband, who also happens to kidnap people and butcher them as a 9-to-5. And Aya knows that, but she's a kid. The fact that he's cheating on her mom is just as much, if not more, of a conflict for her than him being a mass murderer. She's known both sides of him pretty much her entire life, and the two of them only got closer after the mom passed away, so it's understandable from a kid's perspective that she loves and wants to protect him while also knowing he's doing bad shit. The events of the game kick off when the bodies of the people that the father's killed come back to life trying to kill him as the result of a curse. So despite what the game might look like, it's actually a game about trying to find and save your father. It's a pretty neat premise. There's a couple cool puzzles here and there, but ultimately it's pretty standard stuff. You're gonna die a lot. Oh shit, yeah. Yeah. Wait, what? Wait, what the fuck? Most of the meat of the story is told to you through these flashbacks. You get to see how the dad cheating on his wife, and killing people, but that's less of a big deal, affects the family. And the mom isn't unaware of all this, or even being threatened to stay quiet that we see. She still sees some of the man she loves in her husband and can't bring herself to stop supporting him. It's a surprisingly tasteful portrayal of gaslighting and the bystander effect for a game about a guy who saws people in half. Spoilers! The end of the game reveals that not only did the dad kill the mom, but he also plans to kill Aya and turn her into a doll so she can be pure forever. So the game does end up with you running away from the abusive mad scientist father, but it gets there in a pretty interesting way. Then he catches Aya and turns her into a doll. Unless you happen to read the assistant's diary at one point in the game, which then allows you to bandage her wounds, which then allows her to come save Aya from her dad. Then when the day is saved, you get a little flash forward and see that Aya's grown up to be a little mass murderer herself. Alright, solid first roll. Let's see what's next. I don't know what that is. Hello Charlotte is weird. Like, even for this type of game, it's really weird. It stars Charlotte, a young girl who's a puppet, basically a living being that exists to be controlled by a puppeteer. That's you, the player. Charlotte will directly address the audience at multiple points in the game, and the puppet-puppeteer dynamic kind of works the audience into the game in a way that feels natural instead of pretentious or heavy-handed. Not to say other parts of these games aren't. I say games plural because Hello Charlotte is actually three episodes and a couple of spin-offs that all tie together in continuity while functioning very differently in terms of actual content. Honestly, the first episode is the weakest, and I think that's probably because even the creator has said that they were still figuring out what they want to do with the series while they were making the first one. Charlotte and a boy named Felix jump inside the TV and become closer as friends as they travel from channel to channel while trying to accomplish some sort of mysterious task that Felix seems cagey about. It's a little disjointed, but you can feel the bones of a good story in there. The jokes mostly land really well, and when it needs to shift to something more serious, there's a certain quality to the writing that I really enjoyed. It just feels a little aimless. Important story stuff does happen in episode 1, but not until the tail end, and I don't really want to spoil it. Episode 2 is about Charlotte going to school. She meets a boy named C, who she saves from getting beaten half to death by her classmates because he thinks he's God and is trying to get himself killed so he can go back home. I said these games were weird. Visually, I think episode 2 really steps it up, and the sharp writing that was present in episode 1 finds a good story to go with it about friendship, bullying, depression, social ostracization, suicide, and I'm sad now. There's a specific tone to Hello Charlotte episode 2 that I can't really describe with genre labels, just other media that gives off the same feeling to me. It's a really well-done mix of irreverent comedy and thoughtful, completely unsubtle philosophy that speaks to the depressed visual novel fan in me. I haven't really said anything about episode 3 because anything I could say about episode 3 might be considered a spoiler, and I don't want to spoil these games because they're good and you should play them. 3 takes things in a very different direction while still staying true to the stuff I love about episode 2, and I love it. Hello Charlotte might not be my absolute favorite RPG Maker horror game, but I do think it deserves to transcend the label of RPG Maker horror game like a Yumeniki. Sure, there's some tells like the puzzles and episode 2 even has a battle system in there, but I consistently forgot I was playing something that was made in that engine. If it's not your thing, you'd probably hate it, but if it is your thing, it's incredibly cool and charming. Man, that was a good roll. What do we got next? A lot of the games on the wheel are beloved classics in the world of RPG Maker horror. Desert Nightmare is not one of those games. It's kinda trash. but it's trash in a way that I can kinda get behind. I'm not sure why, but I've always had a soft spot for the desert as a setting. To me, it has all the isolation and mystique of an Arctic tundra without being nearly as overdone. So, if you were to use the desert as a setting for your horror game, you could potentially leverage those things to make it scary. Desert Nightmare doesn't do that. The game starts with Sandra, an angsty teen on a vacation trip with her parents. Well, angsty or backed up, because based on the way her parents are talking, she's apparently stopped at every single bathroom on the way. Tensions reach their peak and Sandra dares her parents to leave without her. And they do. They fucking leave her in the desert. They're not supposed to be, like, abusive or something, they're just sick of her shit. So, after wandering through the desert for about 2 miles, Sandra happens upon Dusty Creek. And the first thing you're gonna notice about Dusty Creek is that all the music is compressed sound files from Silent Hill 2. Considering the name of the town, that probably shouldn't be a huge surprise. Yeah. I don't know this for sure, but I'm about 85% convinced that the idea for this game came because somebody was like, hey, wait a minute. Silent Hill and The Hills Have Eyes both have the word hill in them. Even the dialogue feels a little bit like Silent Hill.
What about that?
Will you hold it for me?
Sure. No problem.
If I kept it, I'm not sure what I might do.
The thing is, the disjointedness of Silent Hill's dialogue usually lends itself to being creepy and off-putting, whereas Desert Nightmare is more just, Anyways, the dog is dead. Are you from this city? Look, I'm gonna be real with you. Desert Nightmare is extremely boring. The awkward dialogue isn't funny enough to carry it, so you're just kind of stuck with bland characters in bland environments doing bland things. Oh no, an ancient Indian burial ground. Oh geez, weird, out of place sex violence stuff. The best thing I can say about the rest of the game is that you do eventually get to meet up with your parents, and they crashed their fucking car, so they did get owned. Yay! The Witch's House is one of the most beloved RPG Maker horror games, and I think I can see why. It's extremely well put together. It might not seem that unique just looking at it, but the art is super consistent, and there's a lot of little touches here and there that add a level of polish to the whole thing. I played the original, but the remake on Steam updates the visuals, and they look nice there too. The gameplay in The Witch's House is primarily centered around the idea of traps. Trial and error puzzles where you're expected to die at least once to figure out the solution. The game makes this very clear up front. It's a game about dying over and over again. I don't know why you have a health bar, everything fucking kills you in one hit. But I don't necessarily have an issue with the trial and error stuff because the puzzle solutions are usually either right near where you died or straightforward enough that you can figure them out pretty quick. It's honestly fun sometimes thinking you've solved a puzzle and then realizing you need to think one step further than you were. And the suddenness of most of these deaths combined with the more subtle scares to create a pretty convincing impression that everything here is out to get you. The only problem with all this is that I think it ends up being more funny than scary sometimes. It's basically horror I wanna be the guy. It follows a young girl. Are you noticing a trend here? Named Viola, who stumbles into a creepy old mansion and gets into wacky hijinks. I said it before, but the puzzles here are kinda neat. It's one of the only games here I never felt tempted to look up a walkthrough for. The invisible chef needs a hand, get it? So instead I'll just take the hands off this teddy bear and... Look at our frog buddy, who can operate machines for us, and also get eaten by a snake for us, cause, yeah, no thanks. Sorry, bud. Mm.
Wait, did his ghost just...
As you progress through the mansion, you find diaries left by the witch of the house. The witch's house's witch. That let on that she was a really lonely and sick child who wasn't loved by her family and ultimately turned to witchcraft to try and get better. This leads to an indeterminate but probably large amount of deaths at the house. It's a pretty simplistic story, but what's there is okay aside from being a little overly edgy at points. Like, even this fucking tadpole is miserable. My dad is dead. He was eaten by a snake.
Aye, that was me.
At the end of the game, you finally confront Ellen, the witch. And it turns out that prior to the events of the game, she actually pretended to be Viola's friend and lured her to the house so that she could steal her body. So you escape from her and your dad fucking blasts her ass and then you go home. Mission accomplished. Except not really. If you beat the game without saving at all, which... No, you get the true ending. Spoilers, the body swap was actually a success, and it happened before the events of the game. You've been playing as Ellen the entire time, trying to escape because giving Viola your dying body also gave her control of the entire house. Meaning Viola's father just shot Viola. Oh, fuck you. It's a wild twist that I'm of two minds about. On one hand, it's pretty well executed, and kinda neatly foreshadowed, with the puzzle solutions getting more weirdly sadistic over the course of the game. But on the other hand, it's probably better to play this game knowing the twist beforehand, because otherwise there's really nothing to latch onto in the story. Viola and Ellen don't really feel like characters, and I do feel bad for Viola, but I would feel bad for anybody in that situation. Ellen apparently gets fleshed out more in the prequel manga, but I don't care. It all amounts to, aha, this character you didn't know anything about is actually this other character you knew a little bit about. I don't really feel betrayed or like the game pulled one over on me, it's just sort of miserable for the sake of being miserable. You know what? Fuck this. There we go. Did it. Got the good ending. Okay, last one. Please be good. EB, not IB, not LB, is my favorite RPG Maker game. It's one of my favorite horror games. It's actually the game that made me decide to get into horror in general. It all starts with this little girl named Eve. Apparently in the Japanese version it's supposed to be like Eve, but it just got translated literally. She goes to an art gallery with her parents. Immediately, the presentation in this thing is just ridiculous. You wander around and see a bunch of unique art installations that give a ton of believability and depth to the setting, and also foreshadow the events of the game in a lot of ways. You can't read all the words on the signs because you're a little kid, and it's really easy to get lost in here. Uh-oh. Hello? I mean, this is just a pixelated game, so it's really nuts. This whole bit here was where I first thought, damn, this RPG Maker thing can kind of do horror, huh? You wander around the empty gallery and hear footsteps, and every art installation seems to slowly be turning on you. It's uncanny and really emulates the childhood fear of darkness really well. And then you jump into the scariest painting out of all of them, because fuck it. This is where the majority of EB takes place, the world inside the paintings of the gallery, where all the enemies and puzzles and even color palettes are all based on the works of a single fictional artist named Gertena. Gertena?
Gertena.
I really love that it feels like he's got a canon, thought-out body of work. It gives the stuff you see context without needing to explain it fully. And basing everything off the paintings gives you the license to do a lot of really creative stuff. Huh. Oh, fuck. Oh, this is you in the painting? You look great, man, yeah. Listen, I just gotta use this as a bridge real quick. I'll try to be careful, but... Your health in-universe is determined by a rose you carry around. Lose petals off the rose, you take damage. That's how you find this guy, by saving his blue rose from- Jesus, shit! His name is Gary. He's an adult who got stuck in the painting world, same as you. I like him. The dynamic between this adorable dork and Ebe, a frankly, kinda creepy child, that relationship is a big part of the game's appeal. It's to the point that the ending you get, and even a lot of events along the way, are affected by how close the two are. Little things like how much you talk to Gary, or how much you interact with objects that'll prompt him to tell you about himself, move a sort of hidden meter that affect his relationship with Ebe and his ability to deal with the horrors of the gallery. He's so stupid, he's literally the perfect man. You also meet Mary, another little girl who's stuck in the painting world. She's... smart. At this point, I don't want to say too much else about the story because it goes some really interesting directions, and I think you should play it. Go ahead. I'll wait. It's like 3 hours. Are you done? This shit ruled, right? It's creepy, but stylistically elegant at the same time. And it's sad, but it also doesn't take itself too seriously. It reminds me a little bit of Rule of Rose, if it weren't as depressing. And anything that reminds me of Rule of Rose is good in my book. I could talk about that game forever. I could, like, fill a YouTube video with stuff. Ebe is one of those games that once every couple of years I'll think to myself, yeah, I'll replay some of that, and then I enter a fugue state, and when I wake up, I've finished it again. If you haven't played it, play it. And if you haven't played any RPG Maker games, I think it's a really, really great starting point. Alright, so now that we've seen all of the things that RPG Maker is capable of, what's the best game of the bunch? It's Ebe, it's clearly Ebe. Besides that, though, I would say the scariest game of the bunch is probably The Witch's House. Sure, it's a lot of goofy jump scares, but it's all in good fun, and even though I ragged on the twist, it did make me kind of upset, so I guess it worked in that regard. Overall, though, Hello Charlotte, specifically Episode 2, is my favorite of these games. It had the biggest effect on me in terms of mood and visuals and just making me feel horror. You might not find it scary in the traditional sense, but the draw of horror to me is the creativity you can leverage to explore a broad range of negative emotions. There's this sense that you can do whatever you want, as long as it serves the end goal of making the audience confront your particular cocktail of discomfort. Hello Charlotte definitely does whatever it wants, and it's also pretty good at making me feel uncomfortable. So check it out, and check out one of the hundreds of other RPG Maker games that I didn't cover in this video. You might find one of your new favorite horror games. Or you'll find, like, a creepypasta RPG, which is, like, you're gonna find a lot of those.